Man, last year was a wild ride. It was absolutely thrilling and such a privilege to have a front row seat to see what God did, which was just tremendous. And I just really want to say how proud I am of to be a part of this church, to be a part of this phenomenal team. And I just want to commend to you just a vote of appreciation to the phenomenal staff team that we have at Rosebank that worked tirelessly last year, that just adapted relentlessly, new regulations, new, and we're adapting and just continuously improved everything through the year. I'm so proud of our team and all that we did. And I want to commend to you as well. I mentioned this in the intro to my AGM report, just your leaders, your elected leaders last year, the elders, deacons, church council of the year last year, that not only provided just immense support to the staff to enable us to do what we needed to do, but man, just like handled a bunch of huge decisions. Your elected leadership last year really stood up and helped navigate the ship of Rosebank through what was, you know, really just a challenging year. And so I really just want to thank Tito, who was our council chair last year, and then all of our council members, the elders of last year, deacons and staff. So just thank you to everybody. So now, chance to look forward a little bit. So one of the things we were working on last year amidst all the change and things was to start to really think to ourselves, begin a process of just trying to think about where is God leading us as a church? What in particular should we be focusing on as a church over the next year or even more than that? And which is really quite an interesting question. And so even if I had to pose that question here tonight and when I was online, kind of ask you, hey, so, you know, what's the most important thing about church? What should we be focusing on? I think we get as many different answers as there are people in the room. And especially if we had to like list them and like prioritize them. So for example, some people might say, you know, Bible teaching, it might be prayer, it might be worship, it might be social upliftment in the community, it might be world missions, it might be cultural engagement, it might be retaining a distinct identity, etc. There may be all of these, you know, different things that we should be focusing on this, and you've seen so many amazing things. As you watch those, you're like, yeah, I'm so glad we did that. That's I was cheering on, you know. Yeah. So there'd be all these like different views on what's important to a church. And then you try to rank them. And if you just take that exercise, that list that I gave you, something like, you know, 12 different things, you have to try and prioritize them. If you do the maths on how many different combinations are possible, over 400 million. Okay, that's how many, that's like if you had to just get an opinion on what's important to church, what's most important for church, that's how complex that can be. That's how rich church is. That's how rich Christian communities, that's how rich the kingdom of God is. You add to that the fact that in the New Testament, like there's like at least 80 different metaphors given to describe the church, like the family of God, like a royal priesthood, like a building, like a vine, like a, you know, and all these different metaphors, and they all highlight a distinct beauty or aspect of church that's important, 80 of them. And you go, okay, let's take all these things into account, and you realize, man, like trying to like narrow down a sense of what do we prioritize, what do we focus on is a complex task. How do we do that? Answer. Please welcome on stage the Nexus. So the Nexus is not the latest iPhone. If you guys watch our social media, the Candace and the team social media, it's amazing. But it's not the latest iPhone. It is not the next vaccine. Right? It is not the latest Marvel movie. What it simply is a tool that we've been working on all through last year, pastors, ministry leaders, elders of last year, guys this year as well, a tool to just help bring into focus what we should be focusing on as a church. That's what it is. It doesn't tell us what to do. It tells us, it kind of gives us a shape for getting to what we should be doing. In other words, it's a tool to bring into focus what we should be focusing on. And so I want to take you through that tonight. Now, let me just like say as a disclaimer that when we did this as a ministry team end of last year, it took us the whole day. When we did it earlier this year with the bringing the new leadership team on board, it took us a couple of hours. I'm going to try to do it. I'm going to try my best. 30 minutes. So here we go. You can imagine that this is not going to be a simple tool because of the rich complexity and beauty of church. So it's not simple. It's not simplistic. There cannot be a simplistic. It's just too amazing. So what it is, is a combination of bringing together what we call three ministry vectors. And vector was kind of a word chosen because a vector means something that has weight or substance, but also direction. And so it's bringing into one page, into one view, three different vantage points, three ways of looking at church that together kind of generate a sense for us of what should be important in a church. So perhaps vantage point is a better terminology. Three vantage points looking at church. And when we look at them together, we start to get a sense of clarity about where God might be leading us as a church. Okay, so let's just jump into it. So three vectors. So vector number one, and I'm just going to run through these really quickly. And honestly, my aim, guys, tonight and watching online, is not onboard you all into the details of this, although it's marvelous, and I wish we could do that. I could talk about it all night. But it's just to kind of give you the sense of intentionality. I'm just a big believer in the fact that spiritual formation does not happen to us by accident. That was the rule of life intro. You do not accidentally become more like Jesus individually, and a church does not accidentally fulfill its commission from God. Like there's some intentionality there. And that's what this represents. It could change 1,000 times over the next couple of years. But what this is a way of trying to think hard and think clearly and with these biblical lenses about how God is leading us. And that's what I want you to see tonight. So vector number one is really just bringing before our view what we call the discipleship paradigm. Discipleship paradigm. This is obvious. When you're trying to think about what should a church be doing, you would want to take cognizance of the Great Commission to make disciples of all nations. This is an easy answer. I remember even, I think at my interview, the question was like, what is the mission of the church? The answer is the same for every single church, really. It's to make disciples of all nations, beginning where you are. And so, we want to be talking about that. We want to be talking about what it means to make a disciple. Now, I'm not going to spend too much time on this. You can bring up the paradigm, guys, upstairs. Thank you. I'm not going to spend too much time on this because for those of you who've been at Rosebank for a while, largely what it is, at least on the bottom, is the idea of moving to the right. Do you guys remember that? I remember when I came and visited Rosebank a long time ago, there was something, I think it was on the wall there. I'd move. I'm like, what does that mean? You know, and it's this idea of as a person who doesn't know Christ, the discipleship journey is one, it's a journey, a lifelong journey, but it has these distinct stages to it. And so Rosebank's, you know, motto was call, equip, send for the glory of God, and this whole idea of moving to the right. So the only thing we've changed when it comes to the nexus and this discipleship paradigm is we've added a step and we have alliterated those steps, because if it cannot be alliterated, why bother? That's just not fun. Then you can make a cool acronym out of it, or we can alliterate it. And so basically we have these stages in the development of a disciple. What does it mean to be a disciple? And so firstly, the first step is to engage. As a church, we want to engage the unbelievers. We want to engage those who don't know Jesus. We want to introduce them to Jesus. That's the first step, is engage. Then we want to establish people in the faith. We want them to know what it means to be a child in the family of God, to be a citizen in the kingdom of God. What does that look like in everyday life? So establish in the faith. We want to equip them to begin to be mobilized, to be on mission in their homes, workplaces, and social spaces. And lastly, we want to export them, be able to, as a church, just catapult people, mentor people, help people to really close that loop and begin themselves making disciples. So engage, establish, equip, export, and on all of those milestone markers is evangelize, expect, and empower. Right, a whole 5 E's, 6 E's. How cool is that, right? Now listen, let's just acknowledge, as wonderful as this is, a nice color-coded, alliterated diagram, apprenticeship to Jesus cannot really that easily be marked out on a diagram. I wish it was so. But it can't. So you'll look at this and realize there's some nuance here, right? For example, under engaging somebody, I mean, if we had to, again, our stories, testimonies around them, there would be as many different testimonies as there are people, the way that God first reached into somebody's life and brought them to see Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior is remarkably different. And so there's like a spectrum, even under engage, where somebody might move from being completely skeptical to maybe be moved along to be indifferent, to maybe from indifferent to curious, to maybe from curious to interested, and then at some point make the decision to become a follower of Jesus Christ. And so there's a whole spectrum there, but the moment they become a believer, there is at least there a defined moment. This point where you declare to people that you have become a follower of Jesus, your baptism, you've been transferred from the domain of darkness into the kingdom of the beloved Son, right? And so there's definitely a moment where you know you are now have kind of, as it were, moved out of engage and you're now being established in the faith. But then think about establish. When do you graduate from being established in the faith? When are you like, all right, I got this. I'm done. I have perfect knowledge about what it means to be a dad and a husband and a worker. Like, I'm cool, you know. Like, you never do. You can't actually draw a line there because you're never done with being established in the faith. But at some point in that process, there does come this moment where you start to, this expectation is placed on you. Now you need to be equipped in a way to become a disciple maker. And in the stories of Jesus and his followers, that actually happens a lot sooner than one might think. And so there's established, there's like this blurred line into equip and then export. Basically, what we're trying to show here when it comes to the process of making a disciple is people move along in a way, moving to the right, in a manner of increasing commitment, self-sacrifice, and self-discipline as you kind of journey along. And as a church, we just want to make sure that the things that we're doing, the programs that we're running, the way we're deploying people and our resources, that we make sure that we are covering those. So that's what that bottom part is for. And to be honest with you, you look around in any kind of church, they all have something similar. They'll have different acronyms. They're not as cool as ours. They don't have like 6, 7 E's, you know. But they'll all have something like this. But we spend a lot of time adding on kind of the Y-axis, if you like, which I've never seen before. I've never done before. It's not something we imported. It's something completely unique to Rosebank and something that we're quite excited about. What that describes, and I know you can't really read it in person or maybe at home you can, but what it describes is the kind of different size dynamics, right? So we've got different gatherings of people in different size dynamics. On a Sunday morning, I hear that there's like a couple hundred people who gather here. I mean, I've yet to see it, to believe it, but I hear there's like a large group of people that gather, you know, on a Sunday. Then during the week, we have community group meetings happening, 10 to 15 people, you know, meeting together. We have Life and Life Missional Discipleship Groups meetings, so people meeting in smaller circumstances. And the key is recognizing that as Jesus made disciples, he spent time with the 3, he spent time with the 12, he deployed the 72, he met in temples and spoke to people gathered in temples. He met on mountainsides and spoke to thousands gathered on mountainsides. And so it's recognizing that God uses people to disciple us differently in different relational contexts. I wish I could say so much more about this because I think it's so important because of a church the size of Rosebank Union. But suffice to say, when you add that thing, that Y-axis, what we're showing is as you move down from the large gathering to being in community, in committed community with smaller groups of people, what is increasing accountability, vulnerability, and commitment, which is important as a disciple of Jesus. You can't just be gathered with hundreds of people around where you can be anonymous. You're not going to grow completely that way. There's got to be this trajectory towards vulnerability, accountability, and commitment in smaller group dynamics. I think you kind of hopefully get the picture. Now, what that means is on a kind of strategic level, you put it all together, is generally what we think and what we see our people start to engage with church, the skeptical or the curious, is generally people are more likely to, you can put up the next slide, thanks Candace. Generally people are more likely to start checking our church where they can be anonymous. So the large size dynamic, so that's the bottom part, is generally where people might come and check you out because it's not, you know, there's no vulnerability there. And so what we see happens is that as you start to move along the spectrum of like journeying closer to Jesus, you start to engage more in size dynamics of smaller groups of people. Now, what's really interesting is that, I mean, for us now in the season, we've realized the whole online space is a completely different way of seeing that size dynamic. There's a completely different level of that size dynamic. But basically, just to say this, I think sometimes as a church, we forget as Christians, if you've been a Christian for a long time, how uncomfortable, how awkward, how challenging it is for somebody who's not a believer to kind of jump into these kind of small group contexts where they're kind of being asked to like share and be vulnerable when they've not yet really matured as a believer. And I'm not saying it doesn't happen. I'm not saying it's not important to do. I'm just saying like generally that's not how people would, you know, engage at a first point, first contact with Jesus. So, for example, my best friend, neighbor, guy I spent a ton of time with on the bicycle. And so a few years ago, I got to baptize him and it was this really special moment. But, you know, he kind of been on the fringes, this really, really committed wife and praying for him, but really wasn't interested in church, thought it was weird, the whole deal. And then kind of just had this moment and this encounter of Jesus. And so the first thing was like, man, you go to a Bible study. And like, I remember like we went for a ride, like the next day, I wasn't in that particular, you know, community group Bible study. So I was waiting like the next morning, I wonder what he's going to say. So like on the bike, I'm like, hey man, so like, how was it, you know? And it was like, dude, what happened there? What are you doing? It's like the people asked me to share my feelings. And then they were like, you know, like asked me to like pray. And like, it's like, it was so like, what is this thing, you know, because of this massive jump, you know, into this kind of vulnerable, intimate space. And so kind of like the idea there is as a church, especially because of our size, is we want to just make sure that we've got these pathways for people to connect and to follow Jesus using these different dynamics. Now, what's interesting is I've spoken about the large, the 1,000 people over here, the small groups, 10 or so, life on life, 3 or so, such an important dynamic. There's an individual space, you and God as well. But what's interesting is this other layer of about of groups of sizes of 20 to 70. And we feel like there's a lot of potential for people to make that transition and to really be helped and propelled in their discipleship to Jesus. So probably said a little bit too much more than I wanted to say on that, but except to kind of show you when it comes to the process of making a disciple, we want to be really intentional in what we're doing. So this paradigm, the main aim of this is, number one, what we want is for ministry leaders and ministry deacons and volunteers, whatever ministry they're involved in, to know what particular purpose their ministry plays within the greater scheme. And I'm a big believer in this. The body of Christ, the metaphor of the body of Christ, is that the gifts are shared among the body. No one person, no one ministry can pull off discipleship on their own, as we celebrated in that video. And so we want people to know kind of that's what those white blocks are, the kind of the unique role that that ministry plays. That's number one. Number two, we want to see where there's maybe overlaps. So maybe where we're channeling a lot of resources and we're doing like the same thing, but like through a bunch of different programs. And number three, also really important, what I'm mainly interested in is where are the gaps? Where are the gaps? Where are we perhaps not being intentional in kind of seeing, in making sure that we're doing our best to make disciples? And I think, I mean, it's just my sense, and as we've spoken about this a little bit, and we haven't done a deep dive on this, just been talking about this paradigm, but sense is engage. Engaging. You'll see why that's important as we come up to the nexus. So that's vector number one, the discipleship paradigm. Basically, how do we as Rosebank, how do we intentionally make sure that we're doing our best to help people follow Jesus? Amen. Vector number two, we'll go through this one, you know, really quickly. Because if you think about that, that's not complete on its own. For example, where does worship come in? Or prayer? Or diversity? Like a focus of how would that figure into this? There's some parts, important aspects of church that won't be covered by this. And so that's where enter vector number two, which you can put that next one up. Thanks. Vector number two is really about the idea of values. Now, I know that has like this corporate legacy and everybody had values and they had things printed out on their walls. And over the last year or so, it's become, well, companies don't stick to that, so they're useless anyway. I'm still a big fan of values because as a Christian, we realize it's not just what you do that's important. It's who you are becoming. It's how you do what you do. Right, it's not just about the results. It's not just about the programs. It's not just about the outputs. It's who we are becoming as a community of people who are following Jesus. So the subject of values is critically important for us. And I came across some resources and some thinking on this. It was so helpful to move away from the static list of 20 different values and it kind of doesn't get you anywhere. So I want to kind of just bring up really quickly, not going to spend time on this because we actually don't take a lot from this particular approach to values, but just highlight different kinds of values. There are different kinds of values. So Patrick Lencioni is an organizational guy, Christian guy. So he kind of talks about four different kinds of values. So number one, you've got core values, things that you will die for, you'll just never remove from those. Number two, permission to play values. So kind of things that maybe aren't core to who you are, but kind of gets you on the field. Like without them, you don't get to play. And number three, what I think is really interesting, inherited values. This idea of these are some things that we've inherited from the past almost accidentally, but realize they actually have shaped us uniquely into who we are as an organizer, as a church. And we want to guard those. Really interesting category. And then the other category that we're most interested in is aspirational values. There are some values, some things we want to be like this, but we're not yet. That's really important. There's some things we want to be like that we are not yet. So how this kind of manifested over the course of last year is I met one-on-one with pastors. I met one-on-one with the elders of the time and asked a set of questions about what do you think is unique about Rosebank? What would you never change about Rosebank? What would you change if you could flick a switch and change something? What would you be? And I kind of designed to kind of pull out a sense of, what's important value-wise, as a church. And you can kind of see in the bullet points there. I won't go through them, but that's kind of how things kind of came out. The important part is aspirational values. There was this overwhelming sense of we would love to be known as a missional church, not just global missions doing amazing there. Thank you, Jenny. Jen and her department. But like as seeing every believer being on mission in the home, workplace, social spaces. We would love to be known as a missional church. Are we there yet? Perhaps not. We would love to be known as a diverse church. Are we there yet? No, we are not. And so I think that was really important is the sense of who are we trying to become and we're not there yet. That's vector number two, values. Vector number three, last one. And then hopefully it's going to come together in the nexus. So vector number three, you think, okay, we're done. That's enough. Goodness gracious, there's a whole list of stuff we're going to do. But, well, we're not quite done yet. This last vector is harder to talk about. Because it's a lot more spiritual. And what I mean by that is it's a sense of leaning into discernment, listening in to what God is saying, to use the language of sermons, Rule of Life recently. What is God's will of direction for our church? How do you discern that? You might remember in that Rule of Life sermon, like the world, the word, and the whisper. You know, that sense of what God is saying to us as we're praying, as we're listening to God. Like this has got to be important for us, right? It can't just be purely mechanical. And believe me, as somebody who's very left brain orientated, I could easily default to just the graphs and the charts. I mean, give me a color-coded graph, that is alliterated and will change the world. Well, I mean, no. Like we're a church, and like if you study, study, just read the New Testament church, the book of Acts, you kind of get the sense of a lot of the impetus, a lot of what was propelling the church was this kind of spontaneity fueled by what the disciples or people felt the Holy Spirit was saying to them, and the Apostle Paul bouncing around the Mediterranean, trying to reach different countries. So we've got to capture that as a church, of course. It's not all going to be things that are easily mapped out and that we can strategically plan. And so I came across this little passage, 1 Chronicles 12, verse 32, a number of years ago. I thought it was so helpful. It's a passage that is embedded within a list of names and numbers. And normally you just skip over that, but the guy kind of preaching on this just brought it out. So 1 Chronicles 12, 32 is describing the different tribes, you know, serving the kingdom of David at the time, the number of them, and it was just like this listing the size of the army according to tribe. Not very interesting. Right, it comes to 1 Chronicles 12, 32, and it says, of the tribe of Issachar, men who had understanding of the times to know what Israel ought to do, 200 of them and all their kinsmen. Interesting. If you're going to read through the list and look at the other tribes, for example, Manasseh, 120,000, Zebulun, 50,000. The next lowest, the next smallest tribe contributing to the kingdom of David at the time was 3,000. These guys, 200. You think of them in the army, you're like, okay, guys, you'll just like sit out. You just go grab yourself a cup of coffee. I mean, 200 of you, we got this. Like, really, what can 200 people meaningfully contribute in an army of the South, like 134,000 or 340,000 of them? But it says there, their role, men of understanding to know what Israel ought to do. Isn't that interesting? Got this army of 340,000, but these are the guys telling them what to do, directing the army efforts. Now, that's really interesting. And you think, well, what faculties do they possess to be able to tell what to do? Men of understanding, what does it mean to understand the times? That mean read the newspaper every day, like be this culturally observant person? No, no, no. In the Old Testament, this idea of understanding comes up like 200 times. It's a major deal. And it's kind of, in the English translation, we think understanding, we think, oh, mental, wisdom. No, no, no. It's actually in the Old Testament always, often, if not always, coupled with wisdom. It's something different to wisdom. You've got wisdom, which is perhaps vector 1 and 2, and thinking, and God-given faculties to think, plan, and understanding. Let me give you some examples, like of how this comes up so that you can see. So for example, Proverbs 24 verse 3. I think there's another example on the screen as well, but I want to read 24 verse 3. Says this, by wisdom a house is built, and by understanding it is established. Wisdom draws the plans, the blueprints, does the engineering calculations, the bill of materials, directs the building. The house is built, but establishing it is this idea of understanding. I really wanted to bring this into that sermon on the God's will of direction, but thought, no, there's not enough time. I'm going to leave it for AGM, but now there's not enough time, so I'm going to leave it for who knows when. One day we'll get to talk about this idea of understanding, but basically it's this heart-level, spirit-prompted leaning into listening what God is saying through prayer. It is a faculty that is spiritually given. As you can go read the story of Solomon, it's really interesting. You know, Solomon asked for wisdom. God gives him wisdom and understanding, spiritually given, and can be, needs to be guarded spiritually. And that is where that's why we as a church fast every month. The sense of dependency on God. You know, to come before him is like this sort of Sabbath moment of God, this all depends on you. Help us, shape us, empower us, this moment of dependency, of declaring our dependency on God. It's why we fast as a church. It's why we pray. And as I mentioned in that video, like we were catapulted into praying as a church as I could never have imagined before. This has got to be an aspect of us thinking about where God is leading us. Has got to be derived, not just from the charts, which are important, the discipleship paradigm, who we are becoming, the values, but also how is God stirring up our hearts and where is he moving us? So, those are the three vectors or three vantage points. We're looking at church, we're looking at it from the angle of how can we be intentional about making disciples. Number two, how can we be intentional about becoming the kind of community God is calling us to be? Number three, how can we be sure that we're actively listening out for what God is saying to us as a church? Now, when you combine these three vantage points, what starts to happen is you start to now boil down all of these different things we could be doing into a sense of what could be really important. And so this is getting close to what the nexus is. It's bringing together these three vectors. Now, I want to say this. It's important to have all three. Just think about if, as a church, as our guiding strategic roadmap, we only had the discipleship paradigm. We never thought about values. We never really listened into what God was doing. Like, we would be mechanical, formulaic, and that's all we would be on its own. What if, as a church, we kind of just had the listening into God moment, the prayer and hearing in and discerning what's happening in our hearts? Well, I mean, that's hard. I mean, as a Christian, like, how do you know with clarity what God is saying? Like really, it could be crazy. That's probably how some cults come into being, with that on its own. I mean, you've got that plus the discipleship paradigm, making sure, hey, is this going to help us ultimately, make disciples? And what if all we had, it was values, would it all just be introspective and who we are and what we're becoming, and we'd never look outward? You see what I mean? We're going to have all three of these on one diagram, helping shape our thinking about what you do as a church. Maybe let me say something else before we get to just explaining that last little bit. But it's just, I'm sharing this with you, church, members of the church. This is your church family. This is the core of the church. People who are interested in how this church works. This document, this isn't something that we would see on the website. It's not something that you're going to see on the walls. Like, this is a leadership document. It's something that we as leaders take seriously in helping us discern, what we are supposed to be doing. So when you bring it all together, what we have is each of those vectors on the outer ring, an understanding of who we are as a church that is established, that is consolidated. Remember, consolidation precedes advance. That is consolidated, that we guard, that we protect, that we're going to make sure is still happening, but there's not a lot of change happening in those areas. So, for example, when it comes to the discipleship paradigm, the things we're doing well, so established ministry, we keep those, they're there, we recognize them, we don't want to ever lose them, but the part in the center. And in some ways, if you look at that little diagram, it looks like a nuclear symbol, right? That was not intentional, although it's quite cool. In the center, where the heat is, like the activity is the outworking of that paradigm. Is honestly, where's the gaps? That's the part that we want to be putting activity into. And I can tell you a lot of that thinking is around engage, how can we as a church more effectively engage our city and believers. So that's there. When it comes to core values, so we've got don't take the four, that was helpful. We've got our core values, a high view of scripture, like that came out unanimously across all those one-on-ones. Like, it's something that is rich heritage of the church that we want to guard and want to protect, this high view of scripture. So core values, we never want to take our focus off them, but where the action is, where the heat is, where the energy, where we're changing things is aspirational values. So you add that to the little in a ring. And then lastly, we've got this idea of kind of the leaning in and listening, and I think in a large part, listening to what God is doing and what he wants us to do is looking back on how he has built us over the years. And I spoke about this a little bit on Sunday, so I'm not going to go into that. But it's our distinctives as a church. What is it that makes Rosebank unique? So for example, we're interdenominational. Well, that's helpful. Like, so we want to hold on to that. And then our distinct calling. So, outer ring, largely unchanging, but we're guarding it. Inner ring is where all the activity is happening. So I think, as you will have heard over a few months now, as we've spoken about this, one thing. Now, let me say, multiple things could come out of this from each area. Sometimes there may be a combination of them. Sometimes all three gravitate to one point. I think we have one thing already, where all three are leading us at least in one direction, and you've heard a lot of talk about that, assignment Joburg. Right? Just the distinctives of Rosebank, the accidental, the inherited values of here we are in this corner, in this location, that came up so much amongst elders. And God has put us here for a reason, we've got to use this platform, etc. That's got to be part of what God is doing. It feeds into engage our direct context. It also means we have to embrace, for example, diversity. Why? Because Joburg's diverse and you cannot engage Joburg, unless you intentionally make that a value and a focus. So coming out of it at the moment is the strong idea of how do we as a church really meaningfully use the platform that we've been given here in Joburg. The reality is the work in Joburg is not done and we are just getting started. Maybe I'll just close by saying this again. Just kind of just dial back a little bit. Big believer in intentionality. At the start of the Rule of Life series, we looked at 2 Peter chapter 1. And I want to just remind you of that. Writing to believers, it says, for this very reason, make every effort to add to your faith supplemented virtue. Virtue, which is this moral energy, this desire to do good. And then virtue, knowledge, self-control, perseverance. Make every effort. And you might remember that I said this. I mean, you won't remember. Man, it was 7 weeks ago. I don't remember what I said 7 weeks ago. But there was this idea of like intentionality and effort and God's grace. And how do we see that interaction? And I quoted Dallas Willard, who said that this idea of discipleship is a purposive interaction with grace. That's what we're saying. We're saying we really want to be good stewards of what God has called us to do, of this phenomenal church. And so we're going to put all of our intentionality, all of our best wisdom that we can, going to really lean into hearing from God, but we understand it's a work of His grace. It's a purposive interaction with the grace of God that is going to enable this church to actually expand the boundaries of His kingdom. And I want to say we've already seen God do that. Amen? And so look forward to our journey as we capture what it means to be a city church and take on the assignment of Joburg. That is the Nexus.